If you were the scum of the earth, trapped in Jigsaw's latest, initial, previous, years ago saw traps, what would you do? John Kramer is back. Or rather, he hasn't died yet at this point in the series. He's in between installments here. Adam, Zep, and Tap are dead, and Amanda and Gordon have already been baptized in the Church of the Latter-day Jigsaws. Even with two bright and shiny Stockholm apprentices at his disposal, Johnny Boy's not doing great. He's deep into the denial stage regarding his terminal brain cancer, desperate for anything that'll save his life. He's so desperate, he'll submit himself to an underground experimental trial run by snake oil salesmen, which means no luck for John and no luck for his next batch of deserving victims. It also means that John Kramer's moral code flew out the window way earlier than we all thought it did in the franchise. I'm going to break down the mistakes made, what you should do, and how to beat Jigsaw in Saw X. Jigsaw is taking his one-man mutilation extravaganza international. We're going to have to expand our minds, reset our understanding of logic, and ignore the almost magical ways in which he's able to create elaborate traps in another country with zero prep time and an insane number of resources at his disposal. That way, we can focus on surviving his bloody morality lessons instead of wondering how he literally pulled off any of this in such a short amount of time. Like I said, John's sick. The brain cancer has left him weak, struggling with the day-to-day reality of scribbling saw traps in his little moleskin notebook. That'd be one hell of a thing to leave on a public bus. John's doctor tells him his latest scans show no improvement and that he should try to die easy. John definitely appreciates the irony, but before he's even left the hospital, he's already fantasizing about using his latest contraption on a janitor stealing from hospital patient.
All you have to do is click the dial across the five positions, and you will live to see another day.
While out to lunch, he encounters a fellow patient who tells him that he's been healed since they last saw each other. He shows off his scar and gives John the number of a Norwegian doctor who's using gene therapy and surgery to excise cancer for good. The doctor's daughter, Cecilia, tells John they have to move their secret clinic from country to country because Big Pharma doesn't want people to know that they can be cured. John is a desperate man. This is exactly what he's looking for, and every single one of us would take a risk if we thought it was our last chance. Cecilia tells John she can fit him into her next cycle of patients in Mexico City, and away he goes. Cecilia's driver, Diego, picks him up from the airport, giving him a bloody history lesson on their way to some nondescript part of the sprawling city, where a van cuts them off and two armed men accost John, then sneak him into the clinic. A bit of theater, Cecilia claims, is necessary to keep their work safe. A bit of a red flag. Safe from whom? Does Big Pharma have moles at the airport tailing anyone who looks terminal? Do you know how hit or miss that would be? The only person that they'd be after is you, Cecilia. To find you, they just need to track the shipments of medical equipment and drugs you'd need to operate this clinic in the first place. It's probably more likely that John's about to get his organs harvested for free. And this theater is Cecilia covering her tracks. Gabriella welcomes John to what she says is her family's house. Cecilia is there waiting for him. She gives him a guided tour. Outside, we meet Carlos and his dad, who she says is the land's caretaker. Inside the factory building, we meet Mateo, the anesthesiologist, Valentina, the nurse, and Parker, another patient who's just had the operation for his throat cancer. The next day, John's already on the operating table. Cecilia says she's brought in the best neurosurgeon from Mexico City's best hospital to perform an awake craniotomy, sawing into his skull while he's partially awake so they can make sure his wiring doesn't get crossed while they're removing his tumor. Another red flag. While I believe that anybody can be bought for the right price, the best of any profession isn't going to risk their livelihood in a black market OR like this. Or if they are, I want to talk to them first. If it were me, I'd think Cecilia was overplaying her hand here. Half drugged drugged, John watches video of the surgery before they put him to sleep. John wakes in another part of the city with Cecilia by his side. His vitals look great, and she tells him to relax and not to remove the bandage on his head because it's antibacterial. The placebo effect kicks in, and John starts to feel like a new man. He uses a nearby radio tower to triangulate the location of Cecilia's secret clinic so he can give them a gift for all that they've done. Of course, he arrives to find the house is empty and the lab is basically destroyed, all save a convenient video on the monitor cued to reveal that what he saw during surgery was just a medical school instructional video. He whips off the bandage and finds no scar on his head. And with that, every single one of these idiots deserves to die. Not because they conned Jigsaw, but because of this sloppy D-minus effort. All you had to do was actually cut his head and sew it back up, and he would have never been the wiser. Not until it was too late to find all of you anyway. But of course, that would require more brain power than our little group of miscreants collectively possess. You see, grifts don't really work if you have easily trackable patterns. John finds the taxi driver Diego immediately. He just stakes out the popular monument Diego showed him on their drive. I mean, he does a dude who could easily step on the gas right here and destroy his entire plan. So, if you're in the Jigsaw business, have Amanda drive him to a more discreet location for this first. After telling John where to find the others, Diego wakes in a trap that feels underbaked, not gonna lie. He's limply bound by rope with his hands wrapped in duct tape, holding scalpels. Two bombs have been attached to his forearms using galvanized cable. Panicked, he cuts the rope across his chest and steps away, pulling the starter pin, which doesn't start the timer on the bombs. The countdowns don't begin until after he's played John's cassette, which tells him the scalpels can't cut the cable, but can cut his flesh. The fact that the timer doesn't start until after he listens to the tape means John is triggering the countdown, which makes me wonder what he would have done if we'd just started hacking at her arms before releasing ourselves from the rope. Panic will be your most immediate enemy. If you wake up booby-trapped, catch your breath, observe, plan, then react. Start by slicing off the duct tape and freeing your dominant hand. This gives you a tactile advantage navigating where and how to cut, and it means you won't cut yourself unnecessarily. Turn your arm over. Look at how the cables are attached. Are the ends soldered together to make loops, or are they clipped? In both cases, that is the weakest point of connection. Double check that cutting or breaking them isn't an option. Second, remember you have two big bones in each forearm. Gently pull on the bomb to check whether the cables are wrapped around either bone. It'd suck to hack your arm apart only to find out you have to cut off the whole thing. Again, you and I know that the bombs are only attached to flesh because John gives his victims an actual chance to survive, but Diego wouldn't. There are four cables per bomb. Line up the scalpel with each wire. Slice directly down until the loop wiggles freely. Move to the next and do it again. Work quickly, not sloppily. Otherwise, you're gonna slice through your artery and bleed to death in minutes. Diego wastes so much time trying to escape like Edward's scalpel hands that he barely has half his time left when he starts to cut. Seconds left, he detaches the second bomb and hits the deck as they explode. You gotta love how he dives to the open floor, like there aren't a thousand steel columns to hide behind. John recruits Amanda and Detective Hoffman to help him with the others. Two of them are easy pickings. Valentina's grabbed while being by John in the car, and Mateo leaves the goddamn door open to the clinic where he works as a night janitor. Gabriella's grabbed while wasted in a club bathroom, but the movie skips over how Amanda got her unconscious out afterward. To be honest, that probably wasn't hard. Mexico City has a ridiculously high kidnapping rate. Cecilia is taken from her home, which seems to be about as reliable as she is. She has an entire camera system, but no panic room and no weapons. She doesn't even call anyone. She sees the pig intruder on her roof, runs to the car, and doesn't check the back seat, where John is waiting to sedate her. The foursome wake bound in the factory, which has been jigsawed overnight. Amanda strips Cecilia of her coat and phone and places all of her stuff on a rolling cart in plain view at the center of the room. Seems a little showy to me. Intentional. I'd be wondering why she'd leave all her stuff here with us at all. Of course, John does his holier-than-thou monologue, mentioning that they've stashed all of Cecilia's ill-gotten gains upstairs. John tells Valentina that she's the first one on the chopping block, or should I say, sawing block. Rope is wrapped around her neck, but otherwise her body is untethered. A razor-sharp wire is suspended in front of her, attached to a machine that will slice off her head if she can't use a Geely wire saw to cut off her leg and deposit 3 ounces of bone marrow into a suction tube attached to a nearby scale. That sounds straightforward enough, until she actually pulls the saw from the box, triggering a 3-minute countdown. Why the arbitrary timer, exactly? They know they'll never leave unless they play the game. Who cares if it takes 5 minutes or 4 or 18 to chop off your own leg? People comment that Amanda's a bad Jigsaw replacement because some of her traps are unbeatable, but this is splashing in the same kiddie pool. Geely saws are insanely fast at bone amputations, but we're talking 10 seconds here, just longer than you last in the bedroom. But that's in a modern OR, with a sedated patient in a proper tourniquet and with the meat already cut and stripped from the bone. The actual amputation is the short part. All the prep, so you don't die, can take between 15 and 90 minutes, depending on the body part. Valentina wraps a movie tourniquet around her leg and starts sawing. By the time the leg has come off and the marrow actually reaches the machine, there's only 17 seconds remaining. Of course, it's not enough time. So again, she was like 20 seconds away from giving Jigsaw what he asked for. How do those extra seconds make her less worthy of surviving, exactly? Anyway, maybe that's just my pet peeve. No, if it were me, I would have gone for the suction tube first. It's attached to the machine with a scale. Just yank that sucker over and press down on the scale plate. Could there be a booby trap there too? Sure, but that's true for anywhere in this place. At the very least, if nothing happens and we still trigger the timer, we'd have the scale within reach to add weight if needed. The other non-invasive option, though, is to use the wire saw to cut through the rope around our neck instead of our leg. Thread the wire through, saw away from our flesh, and shimmy down 5 seconds after the timer begins. Also, why aren't any of you other people trying to break your chains while this is happening? That will be you soon enough. Cecilia's phone begins to ring just out of reach, and honestly, what she comes up with to reach it is just clever enough, I almost want her to live. Now, she just so happens to find a weird piece of sharpened metal hanging around, but I'm gonna ignore that for now because what she's about to do could be done without it. She drags Valentina's corpse over and slices it open, yanking out her intestines to use as a rope to pull the cart within reach. My how to beat for quicksand could have gone very differently. She calls someone and tells them she's been kidnapped right before Amanda zaps her and takes the phone away. Cecilia tries to bargain, saying that even though she's a fraud, the actual procedure her father performs is real. John could have it, which Amanda suggests her research says is true. God, I love it. That means this witch heard her dad's Hippocratic oath and sprinted in the opposite direction. Amanda warns John they have a visitor. It's Parker, the other patient. Amanda misdirects him with her pig suit and knocks him the f*** out. When he wakes, he tells John that Cecilia stole from him too. John says he'll let him confront Cecilia once she's played her game. But first, it's Mateo's turn. For the vibe, Billy rolls over to Mateo, who's strapped to an electric chair turned Iron Maiden. A camera shows him the back of his own head, which has been shaved for his own awake craniotomy. John tells him that he'll need to place a large enough piece of his own brain into an enzyme container, which will break it down, closing a circuit in the machine holding the key. Again, he has 3 minutes to do all of that. Normal craniotomies take 1 to 2 hours. Mateo is supposed to open, yank, and let that dissolve in the enzyme tank in 1/20th of that time. Can he get the tissue out in under 3 minutes? Sure, there's no quality of life guarantee, but it is possible. What's not possible is the brain tissue dissolving fast enough for it to matter. The most efficient cell disassociation enzyme for brain tissue is called papain. But even that enzyme requires 30 minutes at 37 degrees Celsius, or 98 degrees Fahrenheit, to break down brain matter. This is an impossible test, nuking any claim to moral superiority John has. Or is it? Without knowing what type of enzyme John is using, everything is up for experimentation. We don't have to use brain tissue to close the electric circuit. Papain works on blood, and blood is a conductor of electricity. It also works on fat-free mass, or any lean body part that doesn't contain excess fat, like your muscles. Not as well as neurons or nerves, but probably well and fast enough for this test. Mateo doesn't know that. It takes an entire minute just to put the electric drill together, but he does manage to cut out a chunk of his brain. But as I predicted, it takes so long to dissolve that the timer runs out and his heat death Iron Maiden slams shut. With dawn approaching, John tells Amanda to release Parker to see if he'll play by the rules. While Gabriella's game begins, she's hoisted into the air, pulled between a chain on her wrist and one on her ankle. She's told she must use the hammer dangling in front of her to free herself while being roasted alive by a radiation machine, or so he says. Hotter chemotherapy radiations only use temps up to 45 degrees Celsius, or 113 degrees Fahrenheit, and are not administered like this. This looks like an infrared lamp, which can burn as high as 300 degrees Celsius or about 600 degrees Fahrenheit, scorching the flesh on her face. Cecilia tells her to go for the foot first, so she'll swing out of the light, which isn't a bad idea. But once her foot is loose, the lamp just slides sideways, and she continues to burn. Finally, she breaks her hand and falls to the floor, but she's badly burned. John tells Amanda to take her to a hospital, but she turns to find Parker holding his gun on them. Just fire, you idiot! What are you waiting for? Oh, dun dun dun, he's been with Cecilia since the beginning. Who saw that coming? Great, now shoot them. Now? How about now? Parker forces John to strap himself into Cecilia's chain and Amanda into another, while Cecilia kills Gabriella by breaking her neck. A sound cuts in from outside. It's Carlos, the kid from earlier who's gotten up at the crack of dawn to come bounce a soccer ball against the factory. Cecilia brings him in and straps him to the device with John out of sheer cartoon villainy. Don't you two have to leave or something? John tells the kid not to pull the lever as the game begins. They're yanked to the floor by their chains, and the blood begins. How lucky that all of this is happening in a factory with giant blood sprinklers already installed. Does this one have a timer, or are we just piped into the city's limitless blood supply? Imagine that utility bill. The machine works so that each person can push the lever to drown the other person, or pull the lever to drown themselves. John tries to save Carlos, but Carlos is a brave little weirdo who takes as much as he can to save John. This one's easy to beat, since there's no way it's limitless. Just take turns with the other person until the supply runs out. Parker and Cecilia leave them to it, and head to the office to retrieve their money. But wouldn't you know it, they were both of them deceived.
If you were the last player, who was supposed to be on the other side of that plank with you?
There's the money.
Okay, you both know what a timer means. Either one of you want to run for that open door? No? The blood stops and the door slams shut, locking them in the office. Remember earlier when I said they should have been using their downtime to remove their chains? Yeah, they come apart easily as John and Amanda twist small knobs on the sides and release themselves, then free Carlos. We learn Diego told John about Parker too, but Hoffman couldn't find him like the others, so they left Cecilia's phone within reach so she could call him for help. Clever. Save for one thing, which we'll get back to in a minute. Toxic gas flows into the office, burning their flesh as a small opening appears in the wall, enough for one of them to stick their head out. Cecilia lunges for it. Parker pulls her away, and they fight until Cecilia gets the upper hand and ends him. So, does that mean the worst one gets to live? Is she just trapped there until she dies? Off if you think the movie's gonna tell you. Yeah, Cecilia is definitely coming back in another installment. This final room is actually escapable for both of them. Even bulletproof glass is breakable if you shoot the same spot enough times. We see Parker break a chair across these windows, but we could use Cecilia's pointed piece of metal to break it, press the tip to the glass, and repeatedly hammer it through. Otherwise, blocking the vents and taking turns of the porthole would have run out the clock too. John hands the blood money to Carlos as a parting gift, and they leave to go make Saw 2. How sweet. Except, you were taken to the facility by two people, John. One was Parker. Did you never wonder what Carlos's dad's role was in all of this? Oh well, I guess. Ignoring the obvious survival no-brainer of just not robbing desperate people who can seek revenge because they have nothing to lose, Diego's, Valentina's, Gabriella's, Cecilia's, and Parker's traps were all escapable. Mateo's, on the other hand, was pretty inescapable, unless you're a chemist. For those reasons, I think Saw X was 83% beaten. Remember the golden rule, don't be a dick.